ocean, love and kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us His precious blood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us His precious blood.
Household groups as well at the same time. It doesn't have to be silent. Well, I'm gonna make a start now. I'm not quite sure that quite everyone's here, but I think enough of us to start. Welcome to church this morning. We have a few visitors with us this morning, so I'm just gonna make sure that everyone understands what we're gonna do. I'm gonna lead from the front to begin with. We'll have a couple of songs. Someone's gonna read the Bible to us. Steve will come up and preach. We'll have another song. We'll pray together, and then we'll go. Lots of things wrong with that. Not exactly what we'd like to do this morning in church, but that's kind of how it's going to go. I asked you a question on Slido, which a number of people have responded to, which is fantastic. What is it that people build their lives upon? There are so many answers, aren't there, here? It was interesting. Some of them come up frequently, and there are many others, just single ideas that people have. Family, right there in the center, is the kind of most common response. Money and career closely follows. No surprises yet, really. Relationships and success. Stuff in their house. Shoes. I don't know if that's a confession, maybe, from someone. Careers, social media, what people think of them. Jesus just popped up in the corner in small writing online. Well, this week, I had the chance to chat with a church family. And we were just talking about their lives and kind of their experience of being Christians for a long time. And as we chatted, it became really clear that they have spent their whole lives really focused on a life of service for the Lord Jesus and taking every opportunity to share Jesus with their neighbors and their colleagues and their friends. And it was interesting because if you look at their situation now, they're not rich, they're not in good health. And yet, as they spoke with me, they had these great smiles on their faces as they recounted time after time that God had been good to them, and time after time that he'd made a path for them to continue in service and to continue loving people. And that was just amazing. Yeah, that really touched me, that you can, that we can build our life on Jesus. There's a passage in Colossians chapter 2 that I thought I could use as we start our time together. This is Paul speaking to the church in Colossae. He says, "Therefore, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him." And there's that word, rooted. Rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. And then carrying on in verse 8, "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." We can build our lives on Jesus and get to the end of our lives full of thanksgiving. And there is a danger that we can be taken captive by all of these things we've just shared and distracted from building our lives upon Jesus. And we're going to hear more from Steve later as he opens Isaiah 2 on that theme, as Isaiah brings God's word to his people. But let me pray as a start that we would be prepared this morning to receive from Christ, as this passage in Colossians says, as God invites us to himself, that we would be prepared to root our lives in Jesus and build on that solid foundation. So let's pray together as we start. Father, what a gift we have received in Jesus, the most precious gift we could have. Father, the most solid foundation that we can build our lives upon. And so this morning we pray, as we come to you, Lord, would we receive more of your grace, more of your steadfast love. Father, would we receive more faith to build our lives on you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the band are going to sing for us our first song. This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King of glory. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
That you would take my place. She would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Those are the words that we just heard sung to us, that we joined in our hearts. Worthy is the Lamb to build your life upon, surely. But have you done that this week? Is that who you've been laying bricks? I know I haven't. So I'm going to lead us in a time of confession now as we reorient our lives and confess where we might have been building elsewhere. So let's pray together. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive honor and glory and blessing. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain for us to build our lives upon. Thank you, Lord God, that you don't just tell us to build our lives upon you, but you show us in the Lord Jesus exactly why we should, because he is worthy. Father, open our eyes that we might see and believe your truth, that we might see and believe your trustworthiness when you speak to us. Father, forgive us this week when we've hedged our bets, when instead of camping out on your truth, we've put a foundation over here and over there, just on the off chance. Father, forgive us for building our lives in other places. Lord, as well as your forgiveness, we need your help. We need your power, Lord. And so we ask that you would free us from doubt that makes us not trust you. Father, we ask that you would increase our faith, that we might believe all of your promises to us are true in Jesus. And Father, we ask that you would break the power of the desires for comfort and wealth that rule over us sometimes. And instead, Lord, would you teach us thankfulness for the Lord Jesus? Father, we ask that you would make our roots grow deep and strong into Jesus, that we will build our lives on him and glorify your name. In his name we pray. Amen. While reading further down in Colossians, we get this promise of forgiveness. You, all of you who are dead in your trespasses, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, while God made you alive together with Christ, with him. Why? How? Because he's forgiven us all of our trespasses. And that is good news. Let's continue singing as the band sing for us, Here is Love.
thy great love and power on me, without measure, full and boundless, drawing out my heart to thee.
Isaiah chapter 54 and 55. Sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. For you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. Fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced. For you will forget the shame of your youth and the reproach of your widowhood. You will remember no more. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, and the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer. The God of the whole earth he is called. For the Lord has called you like a wife deserted and grieved in spirit, like a wife of youth when she is cast off, says your God. For a brief moment I deserted you, but with great compassion I will gather you. In overflowing anger for a moment I hid my face from you, but with everlasting love I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. This is like the days of Noah to me, as I swore that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth. So I have sworn that I will not be angry with you and will not rebuke you. For the mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you. O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony and lay your foundations with sapphires. I will make your pinnacles of agate and your gates of carbuncles and all your wall of precious stones. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. In righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near you. If anyone stirs up strife, it is not from me. Whoever stirs up strife with you shall fall because of you. Behold, I have created the smith who blows the fire of coals and produces a weapon for its purpose. I have also created the ravager to destroy. No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed, and you shall refute every tongue that rises against you in judgment. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication from me, declares the Lord.
Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labour for that which does not satisfy. Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear that your soul may live. And I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you do not know, and a nation that you did not know shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, and of the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off.
Well, very good morning to you. Let me add my welcome to Tommy's. It's good to have you with us this morning, either in person or if you're there following along online. I'm Steve. I'm the pastor of the church here, and we are back in the book of Isaiah and working our way through those two chapters that Roman and Jackie read for us. So I know it's a long passage, and I know if you're sat by an open window, it's chilly in here. So let me pray for us that the Lord would help us as we come to his word. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what we have just read, that your word accomplishes that for which you send it. And so we pray now, Lord, that together as we open your word and look at it, that you would do in us the thing that you have purposed, that you might grow our faith and our trust in the Lord Jesus and our desire to live for his praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, one of my lockdown projects has been reading through the collected writings of a guy called John Murray, a theologian called John Murray, who looks like this. I kind of thought that he looked a bit kind of stern and miserable, but then I realized today, reading on Wikipedia, that he had an eye shot out in the First World War, and one of those eyes is not real. You can work out which one as you look at him. But he was writing in a church magazine in 1970, shortly before he died, and he wrote this: life here and now that is not conditioned by faith in Jesus' first coming and orientated to the hope of his second coming is godless and hopeless. Now, the language might be a little bit obscure, particularly if you've not spent 5 months reading his collected writings. We don't really use conditioned and orientated in the same sort of way today. But still, it is a shockingly blunt way of saying something which we instinctively know to be true. Think about it. Life, without the forgiveness, the mercy, the grace of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, is relentlessly cruel. The reality is that without that, we will never be good enough. You will never match up to your own expectations of yourself. You will be constantly insecure about the opinion of others. You will always be competing in that vain hope that you might at least be, in your perception, better than those around you. We'll always be suppressing guilt for past failures, always squashing it down, trying to live with that suspect feeling that one day we'll be stood in front of our Maker having to give an account of ourselves. You know, conditioning our lives by faith in the cross is essential. So is fixing our eyes on the second coming of Christ, orientating our life towards it, as Murray puts it. Yet without that, life will always be hopeless. If we don't get this, we will always spend our lives kind of grasping after things that we can never quite reach. And when we get what we think we were trying to grasp after, we look at what we've got and we've got nothing. We're straining for that ultimately satisfying experience, whether it's more travel or more adventure or more money or more hobbies or more responsibility or more recognition or more sex or more houses. Yet we get there's an emptiness to it all. Shallowness, a sense that getting more and more of whatever it is meaningless because we die and we're forgotten in exactly the same way as everyone else. You know, no eternity, no point, no purpose, no hope. Life here and now that's not conditioned by faith in Jesus' first coming and orientated to the hope of his second coming is godless and hopeless. And what I want us to see this morning together from Isaiah 54 and 55 is that that's exactly what he is saying in these chapters. Now, really, these two chapters function as a conclusion to Isaiah 53, which, if you were with us back end of March, you will know is that final servant song in Isaiah 53. Glance back at it if you want to in your Bible. This is Isaiah's account of the suffering servant. His explanation of what will become the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ as the suffering servant bore in his body the sins of his people, giving his life in their place. And chapter 54 wants then to say, what does that mean? What does his sacrificial death mean now for Christians, for those who are his people? What are the implications of the cross for God's people? How is life now to be conditioned for God's people, knowing that Christ has done that? And chapter 55 is going, well, what about the rest of the world as well? What does the cross say to the rest of the world? How should their lives be conditioned by the cross? So what I want us to do is just work through those two chapters with two headings. Firstly, chapter 54, Christian, fearlessly live all out for Jesus. Now, glance down at chapter 54 and you'll notice that there are three instructions right towards the beginning of the passage, and they are followed then by a whole host of reasons. So the instructions in chapter 54 are there at the beginning: sing, enlarge the place of their tents, and fear not. So those are in verses 1, 2, and 4. Now the point is that the suffering of the servant in their place has secured a promised end to their suffering. So for a start, the barren one can sing because the children of the desolate one will be more than of the one who is married. This is a glance back to Abraham and Sarah, a signpost that the promises to the barren Sarah will be fulfilled. Her offspring will be more numerous than the sand of the seashore. In verse 2, they're then told to enlarge the place of their tent. Literally, the words here are, you know, stitch an extra panel into your tent. Don't hold back. Make it bigger. Make it stronger. If you can't imagine what that's like, you can speak to Oggy about the difference between an 8-panel gear and a 10-panel gear in Mongolia. This is enlarge the tents. Add a couple more panels and strips into it so that it's bigger. Because the promised land will be possessed by you. The people of God will spread out across the nations. The earth will be full. Finally, then, if you glance down to verse 4, they're instructed to fear not. As they look forward, they should have no fear of being ashamed or disgraced. And in a wonderful picture, they are told in verse 5 that their Maker is their husband, and the cross essentially is this pledge of marriage to them. He's become their Redeemer, rescuing, verse 6, the deserted wife who'd been neglected and abandoned. So in verse 7 and 8, that the exile is over. If you remember, they've been exiled in Babylon, or Isaiah is looking forward to when they are exiled in Babylon and preaching for when they come back. And he's saying, no, that is over now. The servant has come and laid down his life. The floodwaters of verse 9 are past, and God's steadfast love will be more immovable than the mountains. Now, what follows then is a kind of list of what the servant will eventually bring. But before we look at those verses, let me try and explain and remind you of what Isaiah is doing here. If you remember, Isaiah is preaching prophetic sermons. So he's standing at this point in history, preaching to Israel about the time when they will return from exile. Sermons for the future. And as he preaches for that time, he sees the coming of the servant, both his first coming and his second coming. But sort of like a climber making his way up a mountain, he sees both those peaks, Christ's first coming and his second coming. He sees those together because of his perspective in history. So they're distinct events, but they look like they're right alongside one another from where he's standing. But now we come, don't we, and we read Isaiah 54, knowing that we have essentially climbed the first peak in Christ's first coming and his death on the cross, but we're now still looking forward to his return to the second peak. So in verse 11, Isaiah seamlessly moves on to this picture of the final return of the Lord Jesus and paints a sort of Revelation 21 and 22 type picture of the bling of the city of God, if you like. You know, precious stones and gold, the expulsion of all wickedness, the defeat of every enemy. Now, those things are still ahead of us, even though Isaiah 53 is behind us. Now, let's just think about what these mean for us. What is it that the Lord is saying to us through Isaiah here? Well, let me try and put it as simply as I can and try and echo Isaiah's language in these verses. It's something like this. Because Jesus died and because he is coming again, life now is best lived fearlessly and joyfully camping out on his promises. In other words, you know, whatever it is that you do in life, wherever it is that you go, whomever you marry or don't marry, whatever you plan for your life, the explanation for it must be in the great achievements of this servant, the one who died for our sin and is returning in glory. Isaiah says, those things are true. Enlarge your tents on them. You know, make that the bedrock and trust of your hopes and future. Camp here, he says. A number of years ago, I was sat down in my office when I could do that, you know, because it's small and we're allowed people in there. A young man came to see me who was leaving Liverpool with his wife and young children, and we spent some time just chatting about his plans and their hopes and aspirations for the future. And there was lots to admire. There were exciting things that they were looking forward to. But then in a sort of moment of brutal honesty, he looked at me and he said, we're not leaving for the gospel, you know. We're not doing this because we've thought that this is spiritually best for us, he said. I was shocked by his clarity, and we prayed about it earnestly, because like Isaiah says, that's the root of hopelessness and godlessness. The truth is that we can't camp in every place at the same time, can we? It can't both be true that life's purpose is found in knowing Christ and at the same time having everything that I want with myself at the center. Both those things cannot be true. We cannot pitch our tents on both those pitches at the same time. It cannot both be true that Jesus is coming again to judge the living and the dead, following which there is either an eternity in the bliss of his glorious presence or the condemnation of hell. That cannot both be true, and also that life is about cramming as many pleasurable experiences in as you can before you die. Both those things can't be true. And the truth is that your life will be camped in one of them and not both of them. You cannot enlarge your tent in two places at the same time. That's worth saying, isn't it? That doesn't mean that we should all make the same decisions. It doesn't mean that we should all decide to stay in Egbeth. It doesn't mean that we should all leave Egbeth to some far-flung place with the gospel, although it might mean both those things for some of us. Nor does it mean that all of your decisions will always make sense to every other person or have to be approved of by the elders of the church. It doesn't mean that at all, But it does mean that the explanation for what we decide to do in our lives has to find its root in these truths and make sense in the light of Christ's death and his return. You know, my hopes and aspirations for future education, for a place at university, for a career, for travel or for adventure, must be grounded on this foundation. Christ has died, that Christ is coming again, that life is short, eternity is real, and a life trusting God's promises is a life well lived. You know, the way that we parent, whatever it is, that the choices that we make in those great areas of freedom that we have about how we raise our children, whatever we decide, it must demonstrate to our children that these are the foundations that we're building on. If I'm career planning, whatever that might look like, especially at the moment, I must recognize that on the final day, God will not be impressed by my final salary or the level of my responsibility. The way I spend the money that God has entrusted to me, however I choose to do that, and there is great freedom in my choices, must reflect the fact that it is an awful possibility that it is possible to gain the whole world and forfeit my soul. Before we move on, though, from these verses, notice the tone here. I think maybe I don't want to make it sound like a stick to beat you with, because it's not that at all. It's not trying to make us feel guilty as we read these verses. It's trying to inspire us. It's the opposite of beating you with a stick. Isaiah is trying to paint a picture of this beautiful camping place. The mountains are glorious. The view is brilliant. The trustworthiness of the steadfast love of the Lord is a brilliant place to pitch your tent. You know, work and home might be unforgiving, but God, verse 8, is a God of everlasting love and compassion. Janet was a friend of Vanessa and mine, and I don't think she would have minded me describing her as unremarkable. In many ways, her life was very simple and unimpressive to the world. She was never very rich. Thankfully, she was never very poor either. She never really had a career to speak of either. And her and her husband were heavily involved in the life of the local church, so much so that he took early retirement in order to invest his time in the church, but sadly died very shortly after retiring and never got to do that. Janet lived alone for many years. She had no formal role in the local church, and you wouldn't have seen her up the front of church very often either. But the thing about Janet was that she found joy in living fearlessly for the Lord. In the weeks after she died, her sons began working through her stuff and sorting out her affairs. They opened the filing cabinet at home, and they pulled it out, and on top of it was a letter. It read, "Dear boys, if you're reading this, it's because I'm present with my Savior Jesus where I've longed to be. You should find everything in good order." In the days leading up to the funeral, the family were just overwhelmed by a number of people who contacted them. Janet, it turned out, had just been a massive encouragement and a blessing to a wide range of people who she'd helped, she'd shared the gospel with, she'd prayed for, she'd given hospitality to countless individuals. And the legacy of her fearlessly living all out for Jesus continues to be felt in that church family. An apparently unremarkable woman who had pitched big tents on the promises of God and live for his glory. Living fearlessly for Jesus in an anonymous semi-detached house in a 1980s suburban estate in Britain. And she's now in the presence of her God who loved her like a husband and has great joy in store for her. And Isaiah says, live like that. That's life, he says. Secondly, chapter 55, he says, world, come and find what you've been looking for. Now, I said that chapter 54 starts with three instructions. Chapter 55 is likewise arranged around basically three instructions. So let me start by showing you those together. The first one, verse 1, come. This is the call to the thirsty and the hungry to come and buy food. But unusually, they're able to buy without money and without price, which is just as well, because verse 2, they've spent themselves empty on stuff that isn't real food and isn't really satisfying. Now, the image, of course, is, I hesitate to say it, the image I think is a metaphor or possibly a simile. I'm never really sure of the distinction between the two of those things. But anyway, it's one of those. It's It's the real food is not food, it's Jesus. A relationship with the Lord Jesus, the one who called himself living water, the bread of life. And the reason that you can come to him without money and without price is because he has already paid in his death on the cross, Isaiah 53. At the end of verse 2, the instruction to come is replaced with the instruction to listen. Listen, it turns out, is exactly the same as eating and drinking. It's feasting on the words of the cross, words of rich forgiveness and generous love and boundless mercy. Words of wrath turned away, an invitation to God's family made available to all. So much so that the servant of chapter 53 is, in verse 4, called a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander of peoples, who calls strangers into his kingdom because his glory is so great. So come, listen. Finally then, seek the Lord and turn from sin. The same idea in both those words, verse 6. Seeking the Lord and turning from our sin. The world are invited to come and turn to their Maker, turn their back on their sin and their wickedness, leave behind their selfishness and their pride, and find compassion and forgiveness in the ways of the Lord. Now just kind of reassemble this and see what we've got. This is an incredible invitation. Satisfaction, forgiveness, the life that you've been looking for but just have not found. Knowledge of your Maker, who in great compassion invites you to join his family through no effort of your own, unpaid for by us, paid for by him, available to anyone who will hear. Come, listen, turn. Before we go any further, it's worth, isn't it, just making sure that this morning we hear that invitation. You know, whoever you are this morning, wherever you're from, whatever you've done, whatever you believed when you walked in those doors this morning, here is the best invitation you can ever hear. Come. Come to the one who lived and died, the one who has in himself all that you have been looking for. The one of real substance and joy, the one of grace and forgiveness, the one who is promising to return in glory. Listen to him. Turn to him. Liz's story is told in this book, Live Wires. And if you would like a copy of that, there's some copies on the tables outside where you've used the hand sanitizer. You can take one if you'd like one. Liz was the daughter of a bank manager who had a privileged childhood growing up by the seaside. Life was a charm. She had all that she wanted, and she found that she'd got a great skill and flair for cutting hair. I only call for that myself, but I'm sure it's a great thing. And she opened her own salon in her early 20s and left home to do it. She was living the dream. She had all that she ever wanted. She had money, she had relationships, she had independence. She was hanging out with beautiful people. You know, if Instagram had been around at the time, and it wasn't, hers would have been the profile that you wanted to follow and emulate. But the truth was, she couldn't avoid that sense that it was empty. And it wasn't until she heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus and came to realize her need of Christ and turned to him that then she found something worth living for, something that gave her the resources going forwards. And that's it here, isn't it? Come, says Isaiah. Forget the idols that you are feeding yourself on. Come and eat real food. Come and drink proper drink and be satisfied. Interesting, as you read on in Isaiah 55, he addresses the fact that this is a remarkable invitation, so remarkable that you wouldn't even believe it was true. You know, for you or me, we wouldn't even come up with this. This is not a plan or a word that we would say. We wouldn't for a moment imagine that God in all his greatness would come in the person of his son and suffer and die to invite unpaying, unworthy people into his eternal bliss forever and ever. We would dream up the opposite, wouldn't we? Deserving good people coming to a God who is high up and distant and untouchable. But God says what? Verse 8, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. In fact, my thoughts are as high above your thoughts as the heavens are above the earth. But just like rain, verse 9, falls to the earth and waters it, so God's word rains down from heaven and waters our hearts. Verse 11, succeeding in the thing for which I sent it, he says. So that as God's word is spoken, it achieves in the world, in our hearts and our lives, the very plan for which God sent it. You know, so as this invitation is published, as people like us hear the words, come, listen, turn, so we respond, going out in joy and being led forth in peace. Now, of course, this is the confidence, isn't it, for our church. We've got no hope of finding God ourselves. We've got no hope of thinking our way to him. I'm not this morning trying to give you my good ideas about how I think life is best lived or who I think God is. I've got no message of my own. I've got no great ideas to share. We have something miles better than that, don't we? We have the word of God. God speaking to us like rain falling from heaven, accomplishing his purposes, bringing joy and peace that we have never known. The truth is, though, I don't actually have a monopoly on God's word, do I? You have it in your hands this morning. And you can pour it on yourself. You can pour it on your children, on your marriage, on your friendships. As the heavenly rain of God's word transforms our lives, accomplishes his plans and his purposes. You know, we started, didn't we, with John Murray, with this life here and now that's not conditioned by faith in Jesus' first coming and orientated to the hope of his second coming, is godless and hopeless. And Isaiah says, well, that's certainly true. And he puts it more positively, doesn't he? He says, living our lives listening to God's word, fearlessly camping out on God's promises, brings a joy and a satisfaction that will bring life and courage and glory. Well, praise God that that's true, and let's pray as we close. Heavenly Father, how we thank you that your promises to us in the Lord Jesus are the solid ground on which to camp. And we want to pray, please, that you would help us this morning to listen to that wonderful invitation to come, to listen, to seek and turn to you. And we pray that we might enlarge our tents, build our lives, stretch out our trust in your promises, singing praises to you and not fearing the future. Help us, we ask, by your Spirit, through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, the band again to sing for us those great words of "He will hold me fast." I wonder if you want to stand as we listen along to these great words. "He will hold me fast when I fear my faith will fail." Let's stand together and follow along with the words.
Faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter will prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. Are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bore by him at such a cost, he will hold me. He will hold me fast, he will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast.
he bled and died, Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied, he will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the continued blessing of being able to come together and meet in person as a church family. We pray as COVID restrictions continue to ease, Father, that you would increase our love for one another and also the opportunities for practically demonstrating this as we share life together again. We ask, Father, that you would bless the time we spend together in connect groups, that the freedom to meet face to face will grow the unity and bonds of your church, just as the early church lived with generosity, humility, and gladness, that we too would live in the same way. Father, thank you that our young people and children have also been able to return to meeting in person this weekend. We want to pray for them, that you would protect them from COVID, and ask that you will bless them as they learn more about you. Father, we ask that whilst Roots meets outdoors on Sudley Field during this half term, that you would keep them safe, bless them with good weather, and as they learn more about you and the life of Paul, that they would be encouraged to grow in their faith and love for you. Lord, as both impact groups resume meeting in person too, please would you deepen their friendships as they open your word together. May they grow in understanding of who you are and the love you have for them, and would you reveal the plan that you have for the lives of these young people. Father, we also thank you for the leaders of our youth groups and ask that you would inspire and sustain them as they serve this church and the surrounding community in this way. Father, we also want to pray for those who are feeling lonely, isolated, or unable to be with loved ones currently. Please, would you bring them comfort and relief? And would you strengthen those who continue to care for them? Please, Lord, be with those who are grieving at this time too. We remember Chris and Maddie Jones following the passing of Chris's dad, Alan. And we pray that you'll be close to Chris, his mum, Judy, and the family. Please, would you bring them comfort and joy, knowing that Alan loved you and is rejoicing in your presence today. Father, we also want to thank you for the ongoing rollout of the vaccine programme and reduction in COVID cases that we're seeing in this country. We ask that you will help us to make wise decisions as we come out of lockdown, and thank you for the ongoing brilliant work of our health professionals. However, Father, we are mindful that there are many areas of the world that are experiencing a worrying upturn with COVID, and we think especially of India, Japan, and Turkey. And we pray for the authorities and health services in these parts of the world. And we ask for the watching world, particularly the West, to show your compassion as they consider how best to help and share resources. Father God, we also remember the families who are based abroad working to share the gospel at this time. And we do think especially of the Grindies in Kosovo and the Clarks in Greece. And we pray for the Grindies that amidst the unclear COVID restrictions that the church would have wisdom about how and when to meet. And we ask for the continued unity within that church and clarity on the gospel. Thank you for the continued commitment and determination of both of these families to build your church in these countries. And we pray that they would have the opportunity to share the good news in their communities. Finally, Father, we want to give thanks for our leaders and staff team here at church. And we thank you
for all their hard work and commitment as they have led our church through this difficult year. And we pray that you will sustain and keep them too. Thank you for our time together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So let's continue praying together as we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let me close our service with these words from the first chapter of Revelation. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Brilliant. Well, that draws our service to a close. It leaves me with two jobs to do. One is to dismiss you so that you can go outside and mingle in groups of six or two households. The second is to ask for a couple of volunteer households to help us stack some chairs away at the end. Wow, we've got two very rapid hands up there. So the buyers and the crumbs have done it. If you wanted it, it's too late. I'm sorry, you'll have to wait till next week. You've got to be faster than that. So if you guys can just hang on when we dismiss everyone else and we'll explain how that works. Otherwise, as we say, go out into the sunshine, catch up with one another. So front row, if you guys are ready to get your stuff together, if you want to head out the side door, give a wave to the camera, see if you can make wave of the week. No regal waves, we need new ideas. And then the second row, thanks Dave for praying for us. See you guys next week. So there's enthusiastic waving coming from over there. So next row, as you leave, make sure to reciprocate with the wavings. So if you guys want to stand up and head on out too, good to see you. See you next week. There we go. So Katrina, you've had the best sitting wave. I wonder if you're going to get the best wave to the camera. We'll see. Next row, if you guys want to stand and head on out into the sunshine. See you next week. Brilliant. And then the next row, if you guys want to head on out. Some half-hearted teenage waves from the Farrell boys. Good job. Next row, if you guys want to head on out as well. Good to see you, Catherine. Oh, yes, I'll bring it out. If you're hanging outside, I'll bring one out to you. Brilliant. Almost there. Second from the back row, if you guys want to... If you can head out the back door as well if you want. If Sam lets anyone out the door, that is. Good to see you guys. There's not many people to wave you out now, is there? That's very sad. Yeah. Sally, come on, you can... And back row, great to see you guys. See you, Aidan. See you next week. Brilliant. So the way this works, so that we don't have households mingling inside, which we're still not allowed. So Crumbs, if you want to start stacking chairs into that corner in piles of five along that wall. And Byers, if you want to do this.
Must hold.